Today's little lecture is on something you might find familiar, which is energy types. We're going to look at the relationships for potential energy, gravitational, I should say. We'll add that later. Potential energy, kinetic energy. We're going to look at work done a little bit more carefully. We're going to look at a force extension graph to find work done, or force distance graph. We're going to take all of these ideas that we're going to discuss and use them to work out some conversions. What happens when we go from gravitational to kinetic and back again? So just as a warm-up, stop the video and give yourself a few minutes to answer the following questions. What is energy? Number two, list as many types of energy as you can. And number three, give an example of an energy conversion. Right, stop and give yourself 2 or 3 minutes or five, however many you need. Right, you're done. So what did you write as what is energy? The actual definition is the ability to do work, but it is a very abstract concept and difficult to pin down. So don't worry about this one too much. We'll come back to it throughout the entire course. I'll be very interested in everybody's ideas though. In terms of list as many types of energy as you can, let me give you a selection. You would probably have come across the following: gravitational potential, nuclear potential, chemical potential, electrical potential, elastic strain energy, thermal energy, in heat, radiant energy, kinetic energy, internal energy, mechanical, wave energy. These are all ideas that come up when we're looking at the different forms of energy. There's also things like sound energy. And as we go through the physics course, we'll probably simplify this, because what we're getting is a couple of like common ideas throughout the whole section. So for example, kinetic energy is the energy of anything that's moving. So sound energy, which is particles vibrating, is actually a form of kinetic energy. So that's our big bag of energies. We'll come back to them throughout the course, don't worry too much. And then the last thing was give a simple energy conversion. So any conversion from one type of energy to another will do. This one here is a roller coaster, which we'll be revisiting. And here we have a conversion of kinetic to gravitational to kinetic. That's one example. But there are many, many others. So the first thing that I will insist on is the correct units. The formal units for energy are joules. Sometimes kilojoules, megajoules, etc. All of these are appropriate. We'll be coming across something called an e-volt, which is another unit of energy, a little bit later. But these are the SI units of joules. And what we're going to look at is the principle of conservation of energy. That's a fundamental idea behind everything we're doing. And it's the idea of conservation. Energy cannot be created or destroyed. Whatever energy you have before a situation or a conversion, you will have exactly the same amount of energy afterwards. It might be transferred to a less useful form, but it's still transformed. So this is what we call the principle of conservation of energy. It states that energy cannot be created or destroyed. It can only be transferred from one form to another. Now I'm just going to outline here some special kind of energy forms, which are the potential energies. Now, if energy is the ability to do work, to do something useful, potential energies are energies that can be stored to do that work later. And the more common ones are nuclear potential energy, which we don't talk about until topic 8, so sometime next year. But nuclear potential energy is associated with what's going on inside the nucleus. Chemical potential energy is associated with the forces between the electrons and other particles in atoms and molecules. Basically, it's the energy that's released in chemical reactions, right? So when you've got two chemicals that are about to react, those two chemicals are storing a potential to do some work for you later, right? And when they do react, they give off energy that's useful. So for example, sugars in food, they react in the chemical reaction called respiration, and they release energy. We have electrical potential energy, which is to do with forces between the electric charges. We won't talk about those till later on this year. And this one we will talk about now, which is elastic strain energy, which is to do with the forces, energy associated that's stored with the forces needed to change the shape of the object. So we'll talk about that one now. And then lastly, a very, very important type of stored energy, which is gravitational potential energy, which is a type of energy which stores energy because of its height, right? We'll come back to this one in a moment. Okay, so let's get started with some actual definitions we can use. Now, if energy is an ability to do work, what is work? Now, work is a kind of energy transfer. Work is when you take energy and you convert it doing some kind of physical, and we're just going to consider the physical right now. We're going to consider the physical activity, right? So work is an energy transfer when an object is moved by using a force. So if I pick up a box here and I put it there, I'm doing physical work. I am transferring I'm transferring my chemical energy into kinetic energy, right? Which allows me to move that object. I'm doing work in order to make that transfer happen. The word work has a very precise meaning in physics, and it means when a force is applied times the displacement in the direction of the force, okay? So if the force is constant and in the same direction as the movement, we can write work equals force times distance. This is when they're both in the same direction. But if they're not, we need to consider an angle. So for example, if I'm moving here, this object to here by pulling it in this direction, my force and my distance are in the same direction, you see, right? So the work done would be force times distance. But if I do this, if I move that block at an angle, that's not in the same direction because I want the box to go here and I'm using a force that's at an angle to it. So what I have to do, I need to figure out how much of this force is acting in the direction of the distance. And it's actually F cosine theta. So it's this here, which then gives me this equation, work equals force times distance cosine theta. Does that make sense? I hope so. Now, energy, this is really important. Energy is a scalar. So we're not concerned with pluses or minuses in when we're looking for solutions to problems, okay? Force is a vector, but energy is a scalar. For those of you who are mathematicians, you might be wondering, how can work be a scalar if force is a vector? Well, actually, this S is displacement, like force times displacement in the direction of the force. So what we've got here is a vector times a vector, and that does give you a scalar. Okay, so that should make sense now. Now, on occasions, the force that is applied varies. What we've got here is an application of an equation to a situation where the force is constant. I am going to use a force of 10 newtons to pull the box in this direction. My force is not changing. Sometimes though, the force does change. So you have a fluctuating force, in which case what you would have is a graph of force against distance, displacement, right? In this case, we've got a force extension graph, but you could have force over displacement just as easily. Now, in the case that we have a fluctuating force or a changing force, the only way that you can work out the work done is not by using this equation. It's no longer valid because force is different. We have to now use the area under the graph. Okay, so you would work that out by finding the shape and or counting squares or whatever it is you need to do to find the area under the graph for that displacement. Now, what I'm going to ask you to do now is stop the video and answer these questions, your definition questions and questions 1 and 2, to make sure you understand the concepts. Make sure that you check your answers and you tick them if they are correct. Welcome back. So now let's look at gravitational potential energy. Gravitational potential energy is the energy stored in an object due to its position in the gravitational field. The Earth has mass, and so therefore all around it there is a gravitational field. One way of imagining it is a giant elastic band tied to the center of the planet, which is attached to every object that is raised. If you lift this brick, it will, when you let go, suddenly fall back down as if it was tied to the center of the Earth, right? So that's a good way of visualizing how that gravitational field acts. You don't have to do anything when you pick up this brick. Now you've got it up at a height H. You don't need to push it. You don't need to give it any more energy. It has everything it needs to move as soon as you let go. So it's obviously storing energy for later. Now, how do we calculate the amount of energy that an object has? Well, we use a simple expression. We take the floor to be zero, and so we measure the height and we apply it to this formula. Potential energy equals mass times g, which we're going to start using 9.81 as of now, and h in meters, the height above the floor. In later on next year, when you do the high level chapters, you will start to use a reference for h, which is not depending on the floor. Okay, it's actually dependent on another fixed point. But for now, in this equation, h is the height from the floor. Kinetic energy is another favorite equation of mine. It's kinetic energy, the energy of an object that's moving, is equal to 1/2 times mass times its velocity squared. Using those two equations, I'd like you to answer questions 6 to 11. Try those now. So we're going to look at a very simple energy conversion first, a very common one. Here you can see that we have a roller coaster ride, and this is a very, very, very common conversion. See what you think as we watch it. We'll stop it. You can look on the presentation, you can have a watch of it. It might make it a bit physically sick. But as you can see here, there's some amazing energy conversions going on. Okay, so watch it and stop and think about those energy conversions. Maybe write something down. And I hope you got this right, but basically what we're looking at is an energy conversion of kinetic energy to potential. At the bottom of a hill, an object is moving really fast, and as it moves up, it loses that kinetic energy and gains potential energy. At the top, the velocity is zero, but the height is at a maximum. So therefore, it's in that perfect opportunity now to convert the potential energy into kinetic again, now down to this bottom point where we have maximum velocity and minimum height. We're basically saying that the change in potential energy equals change in kinetic energy. So your maximum potential energy, which is mg delta h, the change in height, which for the maximum would be the total height, is going to be equal to 1/2 mv² maximum. If we rearrange this equation, we can find the velocity from the height. The masses on both sides of these equations cancels. We're left with g delta h equals 1/2 v². And we'll rearrange that to give us v squared max equals 2gh, which is a measure of the maximum velocity as a product of its height. This can be used instead of equations of motion. Try the rest of the assignment now, part 3. Don't forget to check your answers and to write down the correct significant figures and the right units, and to show me that you've got the right answer.